I can't believe it. Is it true? Everyone is saying that you ran into a Bigfoot out in the forest when you were camping. I mean, I can believe that you saw a Bigfoot, but come on. Did you really run screaming like a 4-year-old that just saw a spider? I mean, that's the story that's going around, you know. I don't care what they say, but what I do want is to hear it from you. So go on, set the record straight for me and everyone else. Send me an email with all the details of what happened that weekend, and don't leave anything out. You can send your email to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Thank you for joining me once again tonight. Now, before we move on, I just want to mention that for those of you that might be interested, there's a little bit of information regarding Leslie from Canada Cryptids and her situation after the house fire, but I'll put all that on the back end of this video, so stay tuned for that if you're interested. Otherwise, I do hope you're prepared for the journey down into Sasquatch Valley tonight. Now, the weather will be pleasant enough to be sure, but keep in mind, we're less than 48 hours, I think, from a new moon, and that means the night will be a very, very dark one, with only the thinnest sliver of a crescent on the moon to give any light to the sky. And you know, these are the kind of nights that Sasquatches love, because it's almost impossible to see them in the forest. So, are you ready? Me too. Grab your snackage. Let's get on the trail. Just a quick word for everyone. This story was clearly written tongue-in-cheek, but just hang in there. The story, it's there. Nance, please don't use my name, as my friends and others who know me may come to believe that I'm crazy for such a silly-hearted sounding encounter like what I'm going to tell you. Now, is Bigfoot real? Well, I will let you decide for yourself after you hear all of my rather personal and somewhat soul-bearing details of that fateful night's meeting. He was as real as my pride of my multiple awards spanning 20-plus years for my Savannah, Georgia area and the elite Hilton Head, South Carolina sales teams. Oh, what a bore I had become. Yes, my Mr. Hairy Man was more real that night and more magnificent and glowing than any honorable mentions that I had ever received from any place in my life, or from any sales manager, or even from any company's national vice president of sales. And yes, I really had received those kinds of awards, which no one else probably cared about, just me. But my Sasquatch toppled all of those awards. And I stand here today to firmly state I would trade absolutely nothing for the experience of meeting his otherworldly presence. And by the way, did I also trade in my religion along with the bathwater? Oh, heavens, no, no. Just listen. I know you want to know, but was Bigfoot real? I know you're asking that. But must you? Well, yes, I guess you must. See, I was heading home at around 9-ish p.m. after another evening of self-induced workaholic overworking. Yes, indeed. I was that woman, the one who would work any amount of time, and I often worked on into the night, long after any of my comrades had long gone home to their loving man and a delicious dinner before sweetly tucking their little ones into bed. But that wasn't for me. I had no such life or man. But who knows? Maybe Sasquatch would be my man. Let's continue. I had sat there, once again, bent over my cold, uncaring, number one salesperson desk. I had been working up non-turn-downable proposals, with bullseyes on unsuspecting business owners, all in my strictly ordered CRM lists of accountability. I was fully intending to push at least one website package upon each business owner. It was all about me then, you see. It was about making that buck, oh yeah. But it was more about deflating that next best top sales performer, you know, the one that was standing right behind me. And yes, it was about deflating the competing men's egos while I was at it. Sorry, guys. You see, I enjoyed those Monday morning sales meetings when the sales numbers were all read out and I was at the top. But now, well, now I hate to think of just how shallow I used to be and of exactly what frame of mind I operated in during those years. Was it my competitive home upbringing that made me that way? Or was it something else? But I will say, I did earn my money honestly, though I learned from a coworker that I had earned the nickname of Barracuda Becky. Now, this really didn't bother me in the least. But why was I like that? Well, pure and simple, I was an overachiever because I had no other life. There was no loving man waiting for me to arrive home. No, I just seemed to keep picking the wrong Mr. Wonderful. So work and work and work and achieve? Oh, yes, I did. But this night unbeknownst to me, there was a Sasquatch who was waiting patiently down the road a piece for me. Yes, I will tell you, the hairy handsome was real. And the night, well, it was lit up with a lover's lanish moonlight as I left the office building. Everything had seemed normal when I flipped off the fluorescent lights, locked up, and left. I was, as always, perfectly attired in my swanked-out Georgia professionalism, not to mention the really painful, higher-than-they-should-have-been early 2000s style of platform heels. And you know you would never catch me without lipstick on, not even at night. The thing is, everything was about my somewhat fake yet strongly rooted southern appearance. This small-town yokel, unhappy salesperson, had no other fulfilling life to speak of but appearances. But had I really just been dressing up for a man-squatch all these years? So on this, what would become that romantic and wondrous fateful eve in question, had Sasquatch actually known that I would be coming down that road? Did he know that I had no life? Well, well, Mr. Sasquatch, he would indeed be mine, to have, but not to hold. My seemingly gentle and quite hairy one to be would soon shatter all lifelong-held beastly notions that this snootyish 40-something-year-old had about his kind. So this is where the story really begins on that otherwise ordinary evening for me, out on that narrow, low, and almost swampy river road in otherwise quite ordinary, balmy southeast Georgia. Now listen, folks. Don't take a water closet break yet, 'cause here he comes, if you can just hold it just a bit longer. Okay, so in all seriousness, let's back up to right after I had left my office on that famous night. It was only about a 30-minute drive to my home outside the city, and I was now approaching the last leg of my journey before my final destination off Highway 80 outside Savannah. I had my bright headlights on, and I was being wary and cautious as usual, watching closely for the innumerable deer running amok everywhere out there. And just before rounding a curve, right before my last real stretch of road, I saw something unusual off in the distance, something that didn't seem to belong by the road that I knew as well as the back of my hand. There was something huge on the roadside, and I knew immediately this was going to be weird. Now note, there are no rises and falls, mountains or hills in the roads around this area, so you can see pretty good distances, even at night. So as I continued to drive the 55-mile-per-hour speed limit and drew closer to whatever was dangerously close to my Honda CRV's path, I was beginning to recognize this is an animal, and it was a big animal. And this big animal was standing up like a person. As a matter of fact, I'm starting to yell out a word that I had not only not mentioned in polite company, but had never even mentioned in my own presence. Bigfoot. I am now repeatedly yelling aloud in my disbelief. It's a Bigfoot. It's a Bigfoot. I can't believe it's a Bigfoot, but it is. It is. Now, until this point, all my life, I had been the biggest Bigfoot scoffer on the planet. I never failed to roll my eyes when changing the TV channel from any type of Bigfoot shows, and I refused to watch those shows, even when I was begged to by my best friends. Now, my eyes are well trained from many years of being professional, so not to miss a single detail on anything. Missing one detail could literally cost me a paycheck. So, I was astonished when I saw that I was approaching the big guy. And wow, he is nothing short of gorgeous and well-groomed, and I cannot for the life of me figure out, why am I so attracted to him? Has the big guy of the forest just gotten a lot of nasty press? I mean, my big guy seems to be, well, my dream guy for some crazy reason beyond me, but I cannot take my eyes off of him. As I continue to approach, he grows even more grand, with wavy fur that showed golden highlights, and I'm literally wondering if I'm in some kind of trance. I remember never wanting to take my eyes off of him, and I was very sad as I moved past him on the road. I had come within probably 10 feet of my dream guy, as he had just been hanging out right by a highway sign. Now all this wonderment must have literally happened over the course of 10 or 15 seconds at most, but I really felt I had taken in his beauty for a much longer period. He never even looked at me. He stood there in profile, and like I stated, he was apparently just waiting patiently on my car so he could, for whatever reason, cross the road. Now, it's hard for me to explain, however, why, if he was so handsome, why I just kept driving by him. But I would never have thought of stopping. For what, anyway, when you think about it? For what? To ask him to get in my car and maybe be my date at the next debutante Southern ball? Oh, no. I was way too overaged for that and way too over-divorced. But in all seriousness again, in telling the truth of my encounter, Bigfoot had raptured me away. I had never wanted to pass him that night, and I was so very disappointed when I did. I couldn't even get a glimpse of him in my rearview mirror that night. It was much too dark with only tail lights. Sad, so sad. And I do realize this sounds like an unbelievable story, but on a stack of Bibles, it is all true. I would not even tell another soul for nearly 2 weeks after, and then I told my brother. And he retorted, I must have been having some sort of spiritual issue. Oh yeah, that's just the reward I needed to hear for gathering up the courage to even mention my encounter with Bigfoot to him. It was another 2 years before I mentioned this to another soul. After that, it was another 17. But I will never change my story about the night I dropped my Cinderella slipper and Bigfoot found it. Big hairy man, well, you were quite a find, and I thank you so much for our date in time that night. I was apparently very lonely for none other than you. Honestly, I may have been in shock to see such a sight, one that is not supposed to exist. I don't know, shock itself may make events seem supernatural. Another fact I should include that may be pertinent is that about a half mile after passing my Bigfoot, I had to throw on the brakes suddenly as I nearly ran into a pack of about 8 wild pigs who ran right in front of my car. I have never in my life had pigs run out into the road right in front of me. Now, had Bigfoot saved me from wrecking into this large group of swines? By slowing me down just that little bit when I saw him, and I'm sure seconds could have mattered that night. By slowing me down, though, did he save me? Or was my big hairy beast after the other smaller beasts, you know, maybe to catch him some food? I guess I will never know. And here are a few more details on my dashing hairy man. He was probably about 8 feet tall, being that someone told me that 8 feet is the standard height of that type of highway speed limit sign that he was standing by, and his head was even with the top of it. Now, I stand corrected if I'm somewhat off about the sign. Someone will surely let me know. But I tell you, he was huge. Also, I need to mention that this creature had such incredibly toned muscles. They shone through his fur like the most well-toned Olympic athlete ever. But he was completely covered with fur, even his face. He looked so perfectly well-groomed. I can't imagine him hanging out in the swamps or being stinky. Also, he didn't have a pointy-looking head, but he did have a bit longer arms than a normal human. I cannot tell you about his hands and feet, as I was so drawn to his face and body. He just looked so nice, and I can't resist calling him my GQ Johnny Atlas man who got away. Please, don't use my name. Keep me anonymous. Well, thank you to Anonymous for that entertaining but tongue-in-cheek email. And folks, I had planned to record a few more encounters for tonight, but today has been an unusual day, and I'll leave it at that. I'm going to be lucky to get this little bit edited, finished, and put up by 7 p.m. It's 5:09 right now. That should tell you how close I'm cutting it. In the meantime, I do have two things for you. First, I mentioned something about Leslie. Now, after we talked about her total loss of everything last week with her house fire, many of you asked if there was some way to help and support her. Well, the answer is yes. Someone did start a GoFundMe for her. I will put that link in the video description below. And thank you to all of you if you are so kind and generous as to help out. Secondly, I wanted to let you know that although this one was not what I had wanted to put out tonight, I am working on another marathon. I expect I will try to get it done this weekend. Not try, I'm going to. But even today, as I said, things aren't going quite to plan and all these circumstances are beyond my control. You all know what life is. So I had wanted to record a couple more, but they're going to wait. So I apologize. I hope the marathon that I can get up this weekend will help suffice for that. It's already 80% done. I just need to finish that last 20% and then do some final editing and get it loaded. So I should be able to do that this weekend. I want to finish it and get it up for you. Otherwise, I'm going to call it a night and say Auf Wiedersehen. But until we meet again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.